آباء ولغير الله لا نحمي الجباه غرباء وارتضيناها شعارا في الحياة.
الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا من سيئات أعمالنا، من يحده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اعبدوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الحدي حدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending salutations of peace and greetings upon the final Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and seeking refuge from the evil within us and the evil around us, and traveling through this dunya, the land of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whereby we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives dominance of the land to whomever He wills subhanahu wa ta'ala. إن الأرض لله يورثها من يشاء من عباده والآقبة للمتقين. And indeed, when dominance is given to the believers upon this dunya, that's not the real dominance that they want. That's only a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be given position and authority on the land. But the real home and the real abode for the believer, والآقبة للمتقين, that is a real abode for the believer to return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how should the believer be while treading upon this dunya, whereby you find that unfortunately so many of us are so engrossed in this world, in the concept of what is classified as hubb ad-dunya, a love of the world, even that you find the religious clerics and the scholars and those individuals talk about Islam, that you find a great love of hubb ad-dunya. And this was prophesied by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that there will come a time upon the individuals that we will be suffering from al-wahan, will be suffering from this disease. And it was asked, what is al-wahan? Al-wahan, حب الدنيا وكراهة الموت أو كراهية الموت. Al-wahan, this disease that you find, will be a love of this world and a hatred for death, which has been shattered upon many of us. إلا من رحم ربي, except for whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken away from this concept of the love of the dunya. And you find that that is the initial stage of becoming a stranger in this world. That the ghuraba individuals are strange in everything about them, in the way that they conduct themselves. And this concept of staying away from the dunya is taken from none other than manhaj al-anbiya. It's taken from the methodology of the prophets, because they were azhadun nas. They were the most vibrant individuals to stay away from the dunya and focus upon the akhirah and only take from the dunya that which they need. And thus you find that unfortunately at times even the Anbiya fell into the traps of the dunya. And as we highlight, this is not a way to tarnish their creditability, but just to highlight the bashariya of the Anbiya salawatullahi wa salamu alayhim jami'an, that this could happen to them, and likewise it could happen to the common individual, that they could fall into the trap of the dunya. And that's the clearest example that you find of falling into the trap of the dunya is through reading the story of Sulaiman alayhi salam, whereby you find that this noble king, because there were only two righteous kings that you find that trod upon this planet. One was Sulaiman alayhi salam, And the other one was Dawood, the father of Sulaiman alayhi salam. These are the two righteous kings that you find. وَوَهَبْنَا لِدَاوُودَ سُلَيْمَانَ نِعْمَ الْعَبْدُ إِنَّهُ أَوَّابٌ. Indeed, we bestowed a great gift, a blessing upon Dawood. We bestowed upon him Sulaiman alayhi salam, نِعْمَ الْعَبْدُ إِنَّهُ أَوَّابٌ. What a beautiful servant he was, the individual who repented back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as you find in the ayat that they continue, that what happened to Sulaiman alayhi salam, إِذْ عُرِدَ عَلَيْهِ بِالْعَشِيِّ السَّافِنَاتُ الْجِيَادِ. That you find that displayed before him, in front of this individual, Sulaiman alayhi salam, in the afternoon, were the well-trained horses of the highest breed, the highest pedigree. فَقَالَ إِنِّي أَحْبَبْتُ حُبُّ الْخَيْرِ عَنْ ذِكْرِ رَبِّي. Indeed, the love of these horses has taken me away from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala حَتَّى تَوَارَكْ بِالْحِجَابِ. Until the coming of the sun has been hidden, or the veil appears, meaning the night has come, the time of Maghrib has appeared. And you find that this is a natural love that human beings have, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has highlighted inside the Quran that man loves such belongings and possessions. زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ وَالْبَنِينَ وَالْقَنَاطِيرِ الْمُقَنْطَرَةِ مِنَ الذَّهَبِ وَالْفِضَّةِ. The insan loves women, loves property, loves children, loves وَالْخَيْرِ الْمُسَوَّمَةِ, branded stallions, branded horses. In today's language, transport, fast cars, property. Insan loves that. And likewise loves tilth, the land, the property. That's why in human beings, every single human being aspires to have. الْمَالُ وَالْبَنُونَ زِينَةُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. Indeed, wealth and property are the beautiful things that man aspires to have. So this natural love that Sulaiman alayhi salam had is nothing wrong with that. Because every single human being has a love to possess certain possessions. But if you analyze the concept of Sulaiman alayhi salam, that even in his possession of the worldly things, then why did he possess those branded horses? Did he possess those branded horses? Excuse this, I know it's going to hurt quite a few people, like the Arabs possess them today, just to race in the horses, to gamble upon them, to spend millions upon the horses. And that's a fact, that's a reality. Because as I mentioned previously, I'm not a foolish individual. I know what takes place in many of these lands and what these people, how they conduct themselves and what they do with their money. They care more about their horses than they do care about the people in Palestine at the moment. And thus they'll spend millions on these horses to transport them over, to run in their races and to gamble their money. Which is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked them about. As for Sulaiman alayhi salam, he didn't keep it for that purpose. The purpose of Sulaiman alayhi salam was none other than jihad fi sabilillah. So his cause was a noble cause. So he was justified to keep those horses and to train those horses and to nurture those horses and to take care of those horses. And likewise, you find that during this inspection, this parade of the horses coming in front of him, you find that he missed, as the ulama tafaseer they highlight, he missed or he delayed Salat al-Asr. Now obviously, ulama tafaseer have highlighted that this was something permissible, because why? Salah had not been sanctified at a set time. But even then, Sulaiman alayhi salam, he felt bad. That how could my entertaining these horses and watching these horses have distracted me from offering the prayer. And thus you find that even in the Quran, you find حَافِرُوا لَالصَّلَوَاتِ وَالصَّلَاتِ الْوُسْطَى وَقُومُوا لِلَّهِ قَانِتِينَ. Guard your prayers and guard the middle prayer. وَقَوْلُ الرَّاجِحِ. The middle prayer is Salat al-Asr. Is that middle prayer, the late afternoon prayer. In the hadith, you find whoever misses that prayer is as if they've lost all of their worldly possession and all of their family. So you can find the ta'keed of the Prophet Muhammad coming and highlighting the importance. And the ulama of hadith have written the reason why, because Salat al-Asr, many people are so engrossed in their work, trying to finish up their work, etc., that they delay their prayer, or they miss their prayer. And especially that you find in this land, you find concept of qadha, of praying your prayer at a later stage, which is subcontinent culture that you find. Qadha is not to be performed whenever you feel like performing the prayer. Because indeed prayers have been prescribed for the believers in the kitab al-mawquta, set times for you to offer your prayers. Qadha is only there when a person has fallen asleep, or gone unconscious, or has a justified reason, etc., that's allowed. As for this common practice that you find, is against the Sharia given to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But he still felt bad about this action. So we go back to the verse, what do we find? رُدُّوهَا عَلَيَّ فَطَفِقَ مَسْحًا بِالسُّوقِ وَالْأَعْنَاقِ. Bring those fine stallions back to me. Bring my branded horses back to me. And he rubbed their backs and he rubbed their legs. This, according to Arabic language, means he slayed all of them. That's what he done. So there's nothing wrong with him possessing those horses. There's nothing wrong with him in bringing them in front of him. But he felt deep down in his heart that I've been distracted. I've been distracted from the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't need these possessions. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to ask me about these possessions. So this is a lesson that we learned from Sulaiman alayhi salam. And as you find the clarification here, this lapse of behavior is not to tarnish or insult any of the anbiya. It's just an ibrah, a lesson for us to learn from what could be possibly classified as a mistake. And ulama tazkiyah, they highlight, people like Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyah highlights, that when you commit a sin and when you repent, you become far greater than what your state was before. And likewise, the anbiya, their rank is developed even more further. So this slip of Sulaiman alayhi salam excelled him even more. Dawood alayhi salam excelled him even more. Adam alayhi salam, that mistake he made, excelled him even more. That's what happens to the anbiya. And likewise, you find that's how a believer should be as well. That the slip that you make should bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyah highlights, رُبَّ طَاعَةٍ يَجُرُّكَ إِلَى مَعْصِيَةٍ وَرُبَّ مَعْصِيَةٍ تَجُرُّكَ إِلَى الطَّاعَةٍ. That's the state of, unfortunately, many of us is. Sometimes obedience takes you to disobedience. And disobedience takes you to obedience. How is that possible? How is it possible that obedience can take you to disobedience? And how can disobedience take you to obedience? Because disobedience, if you become arrogant, you become flamboyant, you become full of yourself, you become proud, then you enter into ma'asiyah, which is kibr, arrogance. And arrogance is an evil disease. Because arrogance is batr al-haq wa ghamt al-nas. It's to reject the truth and to despise people. To look down upon people. To think you're better than another individual. And this is none other than the way of shaytan. قَالَ أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِنْهُ خَلَقْتَنِي مِنْ نَارٍ وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِنْ طِينٍ. I'm better than him. You created me from fire, you created him from clay. And this unsuriyah that you find racism is also still dominant amongst the Muslim ummah, unfortunately, as well. And likewise, you find that how does disobedience take you to obedience? Because when a person commits a sin, they feel that in their heart, and they have that some level of iman. That drags them and pushes them that the next time I become a better individual. And that should be the state of all of us. That when you make a slip, you make a mistake, you want to become a better individual. That's why Abdullah ibn Mas'ud highlighted, it is only the munafiq, the hypocrite, when he makes a sin, because this concept of what you find of dissecting sins at the moment into major and minor sins. The mu'min is the one who, when he makes a mistake, sees that the mountain is on top of his head. The munafiq is the one who sees when he commits a sin just like a fly at the tip of his nose and brushes it aside. So that's not the way that we should be. We should be feeling that whatever mistake that we make, that we are, there's a mountain about to crumble on top of our head. But this dissection of sins that you find time and time again, this is only for the ulama who make many of these analytical studies, the many who bring out in the open that this is a small sin and this is a major sin. Even the fuqaha have written that a minor sin, if you continuously bistimrar, that will become a kabira, it will become a major sin. So in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's no concept of playing games, of minor sins and major sins. That's, don't look at the magnitude of the sin. Look at the magnitude of the one that you disobeyed. The one that you disobeyed is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, rather than trying to play these modern games with the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thus you find amongst another Nabi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who warned against the dunya, and you find some of the ulama collected these statements talking about Isa ibn Maryam alayhi salam. He used to highlight, لَا يُصِيبُ أَحَدٌ حَقِيقَةُ الْإِيمَانِ. None of you really find a real total understanding of Iman حَتَّى لَا يُبَالِي مَنْ أَكَلَ الدُّنْيَا. Until you don't really care who's eaten from the world. You're not really bothered about who eats what, who gains what, who does what. That's what real Iman is. But if you're always worried about what is taking place on the other side, is it grass greener on the other side? is there other beneficial things in the dunya? Yes, at times there is some beneficial things, but that does not become the ultimate goal of the believer. Likewise, you find that he used to give the maw'idah, the admonition to hawariyun. He used to highlight to them, just like the kings, that just like you leave, the kings leave you with the concept of searching of hikmah and wisdom and gaining it, then leave these individuals to rot away and gain away from the dunya. Just leave them alone. So they leave you with the Islamic sciences, they leave you with the searching of hikmah, then you carry on focusing upon that. And they continue searching for the dunya, then leave them alone and let them continue in their quest for trying to find something from the dunya. Likewise, you find حُبُّ الدُّنْيَا رَأْسْ كُلُّ خَطِيئًا. The love of the world is the head of every single mistake that you make. When you begin to indulge in the dunya, in chasing after the dunya, just like a wild beast chases after the prey, you continue to chase after it. But the sad fact is that many of us are chasing the dunya even more viciously than a wild beast chases after the prey. And we're supposed to be believers, we're supposed to be Muslims of the Sunnah, or people talking about enlightening people about Islam, or in general just the average individual who find that the quest and the thirst for the dunya has taken an understanding which is totally unbelievable at times. And thus you find for dunya khamru shaytan. Thus the dunya becomes yani the alcohol of the devil. Because there are two types of alcohol. The alcohol of the dunya, if you drink it, you'll eventually come to your senses. And this khamr of shaytan, the only time you're going to come back to your senses is when you hit the grave. That's the only time intoxication will be lifted from you. That's why you find many people, they don't commit any major sins inside their life in that essence, in terms of drinking of alcohol, etc. But you find this love of the dunya is penetrated that they don't have time to pray. They don't have time to fast. They don't have time for anything. The only thing that they're worried about is money. Ta'isa abdul dinar wa ta'isa abdul dirham. Wretched is the one who worships the dinar, wretched is the one who worships the dirham. In today's language, the pound and the dollar. That's the only thing that matters for many individuals. As long as they gain that in their life, and they can give up all of their Islamic duties, that's the only thing that would count in front of them. Likewise, you find, اتَّخِذُ الْمَسَاجِدَ مَسَاكِنْ. Take the masajid as your dwelling places. وَاتَّخِذُ بُيُوتَكُمْ كَمَنَازِلِ الْأَضْيَافِ. Take your homes just like a guest. مَا لَكُمْ فِي الْعَالِمِ الْمَنْزِلِ إِنْ أَنْتُمْ إِلَّا عَابِرُ سَبِيلٍ. You have no residing place of this world. You are nothing but wayfarers and travelers traveling throughout this land. Being a stranger inside this dunya is how Isa ibn Maryam advised in his individuals. And likewise, you find وَيْلُ لِصَاحِبِ الدُّنْيَا. Destruction be upon that individual who loves the world. How that individual chases after his dunya and leaves it behind. He places trust in it and it deceives him. Man places his trust in the world and the world deceives him by taking away. Likewise, you find Isa ibn Maryam, he highlighted alayhi salam, كانت الدنيا ولم أكن فيها وتكون ولا أكون فيها. I'm in this world, when it is there, then I'm not involved in it. And when it's not there, I'm not too worried about it. It could be a rough rendition of these words of Isa ibn Maryam. So كانت الدنيا ولم أكن فيها. The dunya is in front of me, but I'm not really engrossed inside it. It's how Isa ibn Maryam is highlighting to take your things from the dunya, what you need, and then to retreat yani away. That's why Shaykh Hussain ibn Taymiyyah highlighted about the dunya is to treat it just like you treat Baytul Khala, just like you treat the lavatory. You only go there عند الحاجة. You only go there for a need. You don't spend hours inside the toilet. You only go there when you need to go there and then you quickly take yourself out. And likewise to the dunya. You enter into the dunya to take your sustenance, take your risk, take your earnings, and then you retreat back to your worship or towards taking care of your family, etc. And thus you find that this world is just one great big ocean. And the ocean, as we know, at times, it's miles to get down to the depth of the ocean. If you don't have the oxygen to breathe, you'll never make it to the bottom. You'll only drown. And thus you find طالب الدنيا مثل شارب ماء البحر. The one who chases, the student, or the one who chases after the dunya, is like the person who drinks from the ocean. كلما ازداد الشربا. Every time you increase in your drinking from the ocean, ازداد عطشا. You increase in your thirst of that ocean حتى يقبله, until the ocean overcomes him and takes him away. There's no way you're ever going to drink the ocean. So you're going to come back time and time again, and eventually the ocean will overtake you. And the ocean being here, none other than the dunya. And that's quite sad it is to find that certain groups of individuals were chasing after dunya more than other individuals. And obviously these words are going to be very harsh, but obviously we have to mention them to be just and to be fair. Those individuals who are classified as ulama al-dawla or ulama al-su. This has been prophesied by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That you find a certain individual, even in disguise, even the addressing of knowledge that you find, that there will be certain individuals who will be chasing after the dunya. And obviously their chasing after the dunya will be a different disguise. To give certain verdicts and certain rulings for the pleasure of the people that govern them. Or to change certain ahkam for the pleasure of those individuals. Or even for the sake of a position or a property will be given to them. And that's been prophesied. So we shouldn't shy away and think these people don't exist. Because these people, they do exist. And even more and more it's becoming evident, you find more and more unfortunate individuals under the so-called banner of Islam are going towards a different direction. بِحَقِّنْ أَقُولُ لَكُمْ إِنَّ شَرَّكُمْ عَمْلًا عَالِمٌ يُحِبُّ الدُّنْيَا. With the truth I tell you these facts. The most evil and wretched individual in front of you upon this land is a scholar who loves the dunya. كيف يكون من أهل العلم من يطلب الكلام ليخبر به الناس. How can this person be a person of knowledge who seeks knowledge just to inform people, just to give them some statements to them. ولا يطلب الكلام ليعمل به. Doesn't seek that knowledge to benefit oneself, to carry out actions, to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And likewise you find Yunus alayhi salam, he highlighted that the scholar loves the world, begins to love this dunya, the blessings and the sweetness of iman are snatched away from that individual. The halawa is taken away from the iman. And those people who know the halawa from talab al-ilm, the sweetness in the seeking after knowledge, the halawa that you find inside there. But obviously many individuals that you find when they're placed in certain position by certain authorities and the halawa is taken away. It just becomes academia. It just becomes academic rhetoric and speech that it becomes. And that's not what Islam is. Islam is a deep religion of zuhud, of abstinence. Especially among such individuals, it creates that prime feel of individuals that people aspire to be like them. Because they're only trying to be like the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. And that's all of these words that you find in the various anbiya brings you to leader of zuhud. Khatamun Nabiyyin ﷺ. He is a prime ideal example for us to emulate and to copy when it comes to zuhud. And many individuals talk about this. About his character and his behavior. We know the following week people are just going to sing qasa'id and burda about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But if you look into their lives, you look at the luxury of these lives and the things that they possess. Because alhamdulillah, I've spent many years in many of these clerics who are talking about their love for the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the saying of anashir. And you find the corruption behind the closed doors. A whole series of lectures could be done about these individuals. Because their love is just a shallow love. They have no real love. They don't support the sunnah, they don't have love for the sunnah, they don't defend the sunnah, they don't speak for the cause of the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. Because once your mentality becomes sick, it only becomes your own personal interpretation. Even a basic hadith of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, مَنْ كَدَبَ عَلَيْهِ مُتْنَعْمِدًا فَلْيَتَبَوَّ مَقَدُهُ مِنَ النَّارِ. Whoever lies upon me intentionally, let him take his place inside the hellfire. Al-hadith مَا رَوَى إِمَامُ بُخَارِي مِنْ صَحِيحٍ. Whoever lies intentionally about me, let him take his seat in the hellfire. These people make up false narrations, make up lies and attribute it to the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. And when you ask them these questions, they have the audacity to say, we know they're liars. لَا نُكَذِّبَ عَلَيْهِ نُكَذِّبْ لَهُ. We don't lie upon him, we lie for his sake. Look how evil these people are. So they're admitting they're lying. They're saying we're lying for his sake. You really think that you can lie for the sake of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ? You really think he needs you? وَاللَّهُ يَعْصِمُكَ مِنَ النَّاسِ. Allah is going to protect you from humanity. What does your defense of the religion do to go and attribute lies to him? Make up virtues that don't even exist. And then come out on the streets marching and say you're defending the honor of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. Juhal, ignorant individuals. That's what these people are. They don't have no real understanding of love of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, what it means. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي. If you claim to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَاتَّبِعُونِي. Follow the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Look at their lives. What is it full of? Going against the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's the criteria in Surah Al-Imran, 3rd chapter of Quran, verse number 21. As Imam Al-Wahid highlights, this is ayat al-ikhtibar or ayat al-imtihan. You want to judge any individual. You want to judge the scholars, look at their lives. Does it preside with the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ? That's what true ulama will be. They want to be like him. They don't say one thing to other individuals and have corruption in their own life and their own manhaj that they follow inside their own private lives. But everything about them aspires to be like the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. And thus you find he becomes, as Ibrahim ﷺ highlighted, that send amongst them one who will yuzakihim, purify them. And as you find the leader of tazkiyah becomes the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not Adnan wa Fulan, not tariqatu shadhiliya, or tariqatu whatever tariqa may be, or the tasawwuf that you find at the moment. Tariqatu Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam is sufficient for us. He is the ideal prime minister. He is the real imam of zuhud and tasawwuf and absence of the dunya that we should all emulate to copy. There's no other tariqa to follow. If people believe there is, that is the real manhaj of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And thus you find, as Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu entered in front of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and found him reclining on a reed mat. Try that someday, a mat made of palm fiber, and you find how it scars your body. Just to stand praying on there, you find if you travel now, people are agitated to pray on there. That's what the Prophet Muhammad was lying upon. Umar ibn Khattab entered. He said, look at the leaders of Kisra, of Qaisar, the Romans, the Persians, look at their life. They lie on beautiful rugs, beautiful life they have. You're the Prophet of Allah, look at the way you lie. So the Prophet Muhammad wanted to teach him a lesson, Umar. This is not what our goal is. This is not what we're doing inside this dunya. مالي وللدنيا وما للدنيا ومالي والذي نفسي بيدي ما مثلي ومثل الدنيا إلا كراكب سار في يوم صائف فاستظل تحت شجرة ساعة من نهار ثم راح وتركها. What is the dunya got to do with me and what have I got to do with the dunya? Indeed my parable is just like that traveler who rests underneath the tree for a short span and then gets up and just goes on his journey. That was the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And thus you find that he prophesied the coming of the dunya upon this ummah. That the dunya will come upon these individuals. And you find the hadith that Abu Ubaidah, he comes, returns back from the man, from the land of Bahrain. He returns back with the ghanima or the property, the ansar, they come out to meet him. And the Prophet Muhammad highlights, أَظُنُّكُمْ قَدْ سَمِعْتُمْ أَنَّ أَبَا عُبَيْدَ قَدْ جَاءَ بِشَيْءٍ. And he knows what the people have come out for, al-ansar. They've come to take some of the booty. Because they had the inclination that we had. But wallahi, once again, you read about the Ansar, and you find how the Prophet Muhammad taught them a lesson. Not in this hadith, but another station that you find, that when they came out and they were saying that, look, everybody takes this, they take this, they take that. That Prophet Muhammad says that, you're taking me. I'm returning back with you to Medina. And they all wept and they all cried. Because that's the real treasure to have. وَالرَّسُولُ فِيكُمْ. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is with you. Return back with him. Let these people go with the dunya. Let them take the excess of the dunya. But you find in this hadith returning back of the ghanima brought back by Abu Ubaidah, I fear for you not poverty. That's not what the Prophet Muhammad feared for us. We're not really poor and downtrodden. The problems that we find at the moment in Gaza and Palestine and Iraq and Kashmir and Afghanistan, it's an easy problem. Because for many of the leaders, it's just flicking of a dime for them. That's all it is. They can just flick a dime and will solve the problems. But they don't have the iman, they don't have the courage anymore. That's why I read a lot about Sirah, that's why I respect certain individuals. I respect Malik Faisal in 1967 when he decided to stop the oil because the war was stopped. But wallahi, some of these people, Maluk at the moment, I don't know what their state is. I don't know what's inside their heart. They don't have no courage at all. They don't have no courage at all no matter what they speak and what they highlight at the moment. It's just a frying of a dime for these individuals. These people, the amount of zeros, the amount of wealth that they have, you can't even count the zeros. You can't count the zeros, the amount of wealth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon them. But if you don't have the iman, you're not going to have the courage. You're not going to have the courage to flick that dime towards the Muslim ummah, to revolve the problems, to solve the problems that many Muslims. So it's not poverty that we fear. That's not what we fear, as highlighted by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But what I fear upon you is the expansion of the dunya upon you. And فَتَنَافَسُوهَا كَمَا تَنَافَسُوهَا وَتُحْلِكُكُمْ كَمَا أَهْلَكَتْهُمْ. You begin to chase after the dunya, rush after the dunya, and expand for it, and it will destroy you just like it destroyed the people before you. التَنَافُسُ لَا إِشَيْءٍ بِمَعْنَى الْمُسَابَقَ إِلَيْهِ. To compete with one another. That is in أَشْرَاطِ السَّاعَةِ. Did you see the barefooted Bedouin Arabs? يَتَطَاوَلُونَ فِي الْبُنْيَانِ. Competing with another in the building of lofty buildings. Travel through the Arab lands at the moment, the building of lofty buildings. For what purpose? One building is built, another one doesn't like it, knock it down, rebuild it again. He's 50 story, and he's 16. He's 50, I'll build mine 60, I'll build mine Mia. Finish. What is this? Games. Games for what purpose? What are you trying to gain from this munafasa, from this competition between yourself? And as you find another hadith, you find ما يخرج الله لكم من زهرة الدنيا. And the blessings will be given to you. Oh, in another hadith was زينتها. The good things of the dunya. What is زهرة الدنيا? Is barakat al-ard. Is the blessings of the land. The blessings of the land is the natural resources. Water, oil, gas. This is a blessing bestowed down by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فقال رجل أو يأتي الخير بالشر يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Can goodness come? Anyway, can evil come after goodness? How can there be evil and goodness? How can they exist together? إن الخير لا يأتي إلا بالخير. Goodness only brings good things. But obviously, if you don't understand that, then good things would bring only evil things. If you have the correct understanding, barakat al-ard will make you flourish upon the land, will make you become dominant. But if you don't have that understanding, then these same barakat al-ard will become shar, become evil for you, and become an evil ending for those individuals. And thus you find that this wealth is green and sweet. That's what dunya is, and wealth is. Something green and sweet. Whoever applies it rightly will find it as a great help. And who takes it wrongfully is like one who eats without being satiated, without being any full. And thus you find continuously he advises his companions to stay away from this dunya. And just like he advised Umar, he advises the son. He advises Ibn Umar as well. He says to him, كن في الدنيا كأنك خريب أو عابر السبيل. Be in this, took him by his shoulder and said to him, be in this world as a traveler, be in this world as a stranger or as a traveler. Those are the two options for a mu'min that you have. You're either a traveler or just a wayfarer, just a person who's passing by. The stranger, sorry, or the wayfarer, or the traveler. And thus you find the explanation is hadith is given, كأنه غريب في الدنيا يتحيل الإقامة. The one who is a غريب, a stranger in this land, is the one who doesn't know where to reside. لكن في بلد غربة, in living in a strange land, surrounded by strange people. فغير متعلق القلب ببلد غربة. He's not really attached to this land. His heart doesn't fit into this land. بل قلبه متعلق بوطنه الذي يرجع إليه. But his heart is linked to the view land he wants to return back to. And obviously you can understand that literally, and the other deeper meaning. As we began with, وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, the final abode for the believers is paradise. That's the real abode that the individual wants to return to. So even if you reside in this land, you don't really have a love for this land. You have that yearning to return back to that initial home that we were all extracted from. As for the individual being عَابِرُ السَّبِيلِ, that the mu'min comes in this dunya as a musafir, غَيْرُ مُقِيم الْبَتَّةِ, has no residence in this country or this land. فَهِمَّتُهُ, and even when he's inside this land, is تَحْسِينَ أَزَّابِ لِلْسَفَرِ, is only to grab those things which will benefit the provision he takes on this journey. So he doesn't concern himself about the other affairs, all he's worried about is to gain those things which will benefit him on the journey. So he doesn't begin to carry the extra things. So whatever he takes in the dunya is what will benefit him directly. And this brings us to the second part, about this cliche that you find people quote about following the way of the Salaf. And we know that the way of the Salaf that you find in khayr, kullu khayr fi ittiba' al-salaf al-salih. All goodness is found in following the pious predecessors. At this moment that you find that this current any statement has become very trivial, doesn't really mean much at the moment personally, whether you call yourself from the name of the Salaf or whatever you want to use. Because the Salaf are those individuals that you find who heard the words of the Qur'an, heard the words of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you find that these individuals, that their quotations and their actions become to a total different direction, or a total different dimension. So we claim to be following such ignoble individuals, but our actions are quite different. Because in the كانوا أسهد الناس في الدنيا, they're the most absolute people staying away from the dunya in the world. وَأَنْتُمْ أَرْغُمُ النَّاسِ فِيهَا, and you are the most desiring of people after it. So it's just a cheap slogan at the moment personally. That's all it is really. That people think that they're aspiring to be like certain individuals. Wallah, you read through the seerah of such individuals. That's when people say that we're men and they were men. Alhamdulillah, there's a great difference between our manhood and their manhood. Because they had a deep conviction, a deep iman, and a deep abstinence to stay away from the dunya. And thus you find that we know that they are the noble people who rectified their aqaid, excelled in their belief, and implemented their noble actions. is what is the true deeper meaning of these individuals. And when you turn to their writings and their compilations, even works of Imam Bukhari and Muslim, you look at their books of Kitab al-Raqa'iq, if you look, read the works of Sahih Bukhari, you look at the book talking about Kitab al-Zuhud, the book of abstinence, the book of softening the heart, look at books of Targhib wa Tarheeb, you look at the works of Imam Ahmad, Imam Ahl al-Sunnah, Kitab al-Zuhud, you look at the works of Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, and to some degree the works of Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, those you know that some of his aqa'id is incorrect. You look at the works of Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali. What makes these individuals become so dominant? What makes it that Torah, what they write, is still in front of us today? Have we ever pondered over that? Why does their Torah, their heritage, still remain today? Quite simply, if they were people who stayed away from the dunya. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them that when their writings come at a later stage, people will be inspired by their writings. People will notice that these people did disassociate themselves from the dunya. And amongst the most famous individuals that you find who remained away from the dunya, and many fruitful statements that you find, for example, is from the statements of Imam al-Hasan al-Basri. This great Imam that you find was amongst those individuals who stayed away from the dunya. إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ أَيَّامُ الْمَجْمُوعَ. All that you are is a group of days clumbered together. كُلَّمَا مَضَى يَوْمٌ مَضَى بَعْدُكَ. Every time a day goes, a part of you is taken away. That's how the believer is inside the dunya. And this brings to mind the statement of Ma'ad ibn Jabal, إِنِّي لَأَحْتَسِبُ نَوْمَتِكَ مَأَحْتَسِبُ قَوْمَتِي. Indeed, I consider my sleep like I consider my waking hours to strengthen me in worship. So everything about the mu'min becomes focused about what the individual does. Every single span, every single second of their life, every single minute of their life becomes focused towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even if it's mundane eating and drinking, it becomes visible that is it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thus you find, كَيْفَ يَفْرَهُ بِالدُّنْيَا مَنْ يَوْمُهُ يَهْدِمُ شَهْرَهُ. How can you be content with this world that you're losing of one day? You slip up on one day, يَهْدِمُ شَهْرَهُ. It destroys one month of your life. وَشَهْرُهُ يَهْدِمُ سَنَتَهُ. You waste one month of your life, you've destroyed one year of your life. وَسَنَتُهُ تَهْدِمُ عُمُرَهُ. You waste one year of your life, it's like you wasted the majority of your years. That's what the Salaf taught us. So it's not something trivial, the wasting of one's time. But like what you find, he highlighted Imam al-Hasan al-Basri, he highlighted أَرْبَعُ مِنْ أَعْلَامِ الشَّقَاوَةِ. There are four signs of shaqa, of your need of being in a state of wretchedness. And amongst those is وَالْحِفْزْ عَلَى الدُّنْيَا. Chasing after the dunya will not give you pleasure. It will give you displeasure. It will give you hardships. So don't think that chasing after dunya and richnesses and property will give you contentment. There's no contentment in chasing after dunya. There may be some form of contentment that every one of us may enjoy. But as for the qina'ah, the real contentment inside the heart, you will never ever find that with fulus. You'll never find that with wealth. Because if that was true, there's millions who went before us who had all of that. And even today that you find, all of a sudden, rich individuals go and commit suicide. So if money buys you pleasure, money buys you peace, then why do you do such actions when it possesses so many possessions of the dunya? And thus you find that the individual should find the balance. أَلَّا تَطْغَوْ فِي الْمِيزَانِ. Don't imbalance, you need the balance. You have to find that preference. And thus you find that the scale that you find, whoever begins to, وَمَنْ أَحَبَّ الدُّنْيَا وَصَرَّتْهُ. Whoever is pleased with the dunya, ذَهَبَ خَوْفُ الْآخِرَةِ. The fear of the akhirah is taken away from the heart of the individual. Meaning you give it such a preference, such a love, the fear of the akhirah is taken away from you. وَمَا مِنْ عَبْدٍ يَزْدَادُ عِلْمًا وَيَزْدَادُ عَلَى الدُّنْيَا حِرْسًا. There's not an individual increases in knowledge and increases in search of the dunya. إِلَّا إِزْدَادَ إِلَى اللَّهِ بُغْضًا وَازْدَادَ مِنَ اللَّهِ بُعْدًا. Except for that person becomes wretched in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and is pushed further away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. بُؤْسًا لِمُحِبِّ الدُّنْيَا. Wretched is the one who loves the dunya. أَيَحِبُّ مَا أَبْغَضَ اللَّهِ. Do you love that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala despises? فَالدُّنْيَا بَحْرٌ عَمِيقٌ. Indeed, the dunya is one great big ocean once again. غَرِقَ فِيهِ أَغْلَبَ الْخَلْقِ. The masses of humanity has already drowned inside that ocean. إِيَّاكُمْ وَمَا شَغَلَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. That's this engrossment, this extra involvement of the dunya that you find. فَإِنَّ الدُّنْيَا كَثِيرَةُ الْأَشْغَالِ. Indeed, this dunya is many commitments. You open up one door of entering into new business contract, into a new venture, in seeking something more, you'll find that 10 other doors of taking up your time with me, and he brought forth for the opening of that one door. And as you find in this concept that you find so much engrossed inside the dunya, that people talk about why is there such a bad state of the Muslims at the moment. It revolves around this concept of the love of the dunya and entering into haram. And as you find in the hadith as narrated in the Sunan of Abu Dawood, that you find that the individuals of Muslim Ummah will be facing certain difficulties. They find in paraphrasing the hadith that the bayatum bil'ina, you begin to deal in the usury transactions and interest, which become common at the moment. And you take the whole of the tails of the cows of the cattle, and you begin to become waraditum bizarra, and you become content with cultivation of the land. And then you find وَتَرَقْتُمُ الْجِهَادَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, and you leave striving in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. صَلَّتَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ بُنَّا, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send down a disgrace upon you and will not lift it from you until you don't return back to your deen. That is the answer, quite simple. Now all those criteria, it fits into the Muslim Ummah at the moment. That we are involved in arena, in usury transaction. We're indulging that on a mass scale. We're involved in cultivation. We're chasing after the dunya, we're holding fast to the dunya. And we left striving and struggling the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will create indignity upon us. And that's those ayat that we talk about, we recite about talking about the other individuals, ضُرِبَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ ذِلَّ عَيْنَ مَا ثُقِفُوا, indignities being smashed upon them wherever they go, we know who it refers to. But many of the ulama tafaseer have highlighted, الْعِبْرَ بِعُمُومِ اللَّفْظِ لَا بِخُصُوصِ السَّبَبِ. Indeed, the lesson is to be taken from the generality of the words, not from the specification of revelation. And so the lesson is that upon us, possibly at the moment, is indignities being smashed upon the Muslim Ummah. In some ulama tafaseer, they highlight, غَيْرِ الْمَغْنُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِينَ. We always talk about them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is angry with them. And they're ignorant individuals. There's nothing preventing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for him subhanahu wa ta'ala to become angry upon this Muslim Ummah. That's right, he will not destroy the Muslim Ummah in its totality. But there's nothing preventing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be angry with us. Give us a few reasons why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be happy with us in our current state that we're in at the moment. What evidence do we have as a Muslim Ummah, not individually, on a global level, what do we have to present in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What do we have to present there? I don't see it as much. وَالْعِلْمُ إِنْدَ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانُ وَتَعَالَى, and he knows best subhanahu wa ta'ala. حِكْمَةُ اللَّهِ بَالِخَ, the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's what you find, that sometimes the shaking that you find is حَتَّى تَرْجِعُوا إِلَى دِينِكُمْ, that you return back to your deen. You become more متمسكين بالدين, you become more stronger in the deen, rushing back to the deen, holding fast to your deen, and the abstinence of staying away from this dunya. بَلْ تُؤْثِرُونَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. Indeed, you chase after this dunya, you prefer this dunya over the akhirah. كَلَّا بَلْ تُحِبُّونَ الْعَاجِلَةَ. Indeed, you love the fleeting temporary things. وَتَذَرُونَ الْآخِرَةَ, you give up the akhirah. That's what many of us have become. And thus you find, فَيَا عَجَبًا مِنْ طَالِبِ الدُّنْيَا وَالْمَوْتِ يَطْلُبَهُ. Strange it is of the individual who seeks after the dunya and death is seeking him. وَيَا عَجَبًا مِنْ بَانِيَ الْقُصُورِ وَالْقَبْرُ مَنْزِلَهُ. Strange is the one who's trying to build a great big lofty palace and his home and his residing place is that grave. وَيَا عَجَبًا مِنْ ضَاحِكٍ بِمِلْءِ فَيْهِ وَالنَّارُ أَمَامَهُ. Strange is the one who laughs with his open mouth and right in front of him is the hellfire. وَيَا عَجَبًا مِنْ عَبْدٍ لَا بِالْكَثِيرِ يَشْبَعُ وَلَا بِالْقَلِيلِ يَقْنَعُ. Strange is the individual who is not full with mass amounts given to them and is not even content with a small amount given to them. Strange we are. Strange individuals we are trodding upon this dunya. And thus you find that the blame of the Salaf doesn't go upon the world, it goes upon us individuals. That we don't know how to use the world. We don't know the correct usage of the world. So we can't blame the dunya. We can only blame ourselves in the way that we've used this word. وَإِنَّمَا ذَمْ رَاجِعٌ إِلَىٰ أَفْعَالِ Adam. Indeed, the blame goes to the son of Adam because he doesn't know what to do upon this land. He doesn't know how to enter upon this land and to deal and interact upon this land. إِنَّمَا الدُّنْيَا إِلَىٰ الْجَنَّةِ. Indeed, this dunya is nothing but a path to paradise. وَالنَّارْ طَرِيقٌ. So both this path, all of this path is either the path of paradise or the path of hellfire. وَالْلَيَالِ مَتْجَرَ الْإِنسَانُ وَالْأَيَّامِ سُوقٌ. The night place is for individual, the shopping malls for the individual, and the daytime is the marketplace. What does it mean? A night of focus and obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the daytime commitment towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not like what we find today, 24-hour shopping that we find at the moment. That's what we've taken, literally the opposite. The real marketplace, the real place of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the most beloved place in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And likewise, the night time is a time for the individual to seek a closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thus you find that the dunya itself tells us, قَدَّالَتِ الدُّنْيَا عَلَى نَفْسِهَا لَوْ كَانَ فِي الْعَالِمِ مَنْ يَسْمَعُ. The dunya calls out to itself, because unfortunately there's no one that really pays attention to the dunya, and says these words, كَمْ وَافِقٍ بِالْعُمْرِ أَفْنَيْتُهُ. How many there are individuals who put their trust in me, I cause them to perish. وَجَامِعٍ بَدَّدْتُ مَا يَجْمَعُ. And how many people they gather whatever they can, بَدَّدَ, and they separate it or break it or remove it or eliminate it. So how many individuals they are, قَدْ نَادَتِ الدُّنْيَا عَلَى نَفْسِهَا. The dunya calls upon itself. لَوْ كَانَ فِي الْعَالَمِ مَنْ يَسْمَعُ. If only there was an individual to pay attention inside this world to the words of the dunya. كَمْ وَاثِقٍ بِالْعُمْرِ أَفْنَيْتُهُ. How the individuals who place their trust in me have caused them to perish. وَجَامِعٍ بَدَّدْتُ مَا يَجْمَعُ. And how many people who gathered their wealth, of course it could be destroyed, taken away from those individuals. So the dunya, when we begin to fail to understand the purpose of dunya. Yes, money and property is important for the individual to leave something behind for their family, except for the Muslim Ummah. But the real goal, the real vision, should be to take that. Take the things of the dunya to take you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Make that journey that takes you to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا وَأَحْسَنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. And don't forget your fair share of the dunya. But that fair share of the dunya, you take it and show goodness to people. وَأَحْسِنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. Show goodness just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed goodness to you. And that's why likewise we find that supplication that I'm sure all of us make. رَبَّنَا أَتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَ وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَ وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. Give us good in this world and give us good in the hereafter as well. That's the way of the believer, to take the good things of the dunya to strengthen the individual in his journey to the akhirah, to use it as a wasila to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not to take that wealth to destroy themselves. And thus you find an individual, you find, will become a stranger. We become a stranger in front of every single individual. Maybe a stranger amongst their own family that people can't seem to understand. Then why has this individual become such a person staying away from the dunya and not engrossed so much inside the dunya? Yes, that's right. Many believers, they don't own many things of the dunya and they never will. Because the only thing that they possess, as the Prophet Muhammad said, that the ulama warathatul anbiya, that the inheritors of the prophets who leave behind nothing. The only thing that they leave behind is al-ilm, knowledge. And whoever takes from it, فَقَدْ أَخَذَ يَنِي حَظًّا وَافِرًا. حَظًّا وَافِرًا, or كَمَا قَالُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, has taken a great portion, يَنِي of true, يَنِي portion of, يَنِي possibly prophethood, or great, يَنِي blessing that individual has taken, of taking that knowledge. They don't leave behind dinar ولا dirham. And that's the only thing that they leave behind. So obviously that is the path that we should all try to be followed. Try to follow that path of the anbiya. And thus you find that some of the Salaf, they often quoted these lines of poetry as well. O people of pleasure of a world that should vanish, adoration of a passing shadow is nothing but foolishness. So you say, looking at that, just like a shadow, it doesn't mean anything. It's just foolishness to try to get tax the shadow. Or like just like throwing a dime into the lake, or trying to catch the moon inside the lake. That's what you're trying to do. You're never going to catch it. You're never going to catch the dunya. Because the only thing, if you had one value of gold, you wouldn't have two values of gold. And the only thing that will quench that thirst will be the turab, will be the dust, will be the earth. And the only time that you'll realize that, أَلْهَاكُمُ التَّكَافِرْ حَتَّى زُرْتُمُ الْمَقَابِرِ. The piling up of this dunya, this rivalry, overtakes you. And the only time you wake up, as we mentioned, of that khamr of the dunya, the khamr of shaytan, is حَتَّى زُرْتُمُ الْمَقَابِرِ, until you visit the graves. And this is none other but a form of kinaya of halati, when you are dead. Not literally go and visit the graves, but when you are dead, that's the time you begin to remember. And that's when you say, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, return me back. لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِي مَا تَرَكْتُ. I can come back and do some righteous actions. كَلَّا إِنَّهَا كَلِمَةٌ وَقَائِلُهَا. There's no point coming back. This is your chance in this dunya to gain the benefit of the dunya inside this dunya, inside the akhirah. And as you will be praised in this dunya when you leave this dunya by the righteous individuals and those people who benefit from you, from the sadaqat that you leave behind for people to take from. And likewise, when you return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there'll be that bushra given to you once again, an immense reward given to those individuals. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala place these words in a mizan of hasanat, give us all the tawfiq and ability to become ghuraba in this world. Wallahi, that's what we want, to become ghuraba. Because the Prophet Muhammad highlighted about who are the ghuraba. The ghuraba, they are people فطوبى للخرباء فطوبى للخرباء. And ulama of hadith have given two explanations of the meaning of tuba. Both of them are synonymous, really, if you ponder over them. The first meaning of tuba is shajaratun fil jannah, is a tree in paradise. And the second meaning is khayrun kathir, much goodness, yani habdun wa'afir, great goodness will be given to the individuals. And who are the ghuraba? Who are the strangers? Unasun salihun, righteous people surrounded by evil people. That's the meaning of ghuraba. And that's what we should aspire to be, inshallah, be in the da'ala, that we claim piety for ourselves. هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنِ اتَّقَى فَلَا تُزَكُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنِ اتَّقَى. Don't claim sanctity for yourself. But at least we can have the aspiration that we want to be on that same manhaj, the same way of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, and somehow fall into that category somewhere along the line of being those ghuraba, being righteous individuals, surrounded by evil individuals and trying to rectify the affairs of the people through the use of the Qur'an and hikmah and the use of the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. Once again, any good has been nothing but the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if incorrect or wrong speech or personal attacks upon any individual or any government or any regime or any beloved individual, that's only been from our own self and the wisdom of shaitan. And the Prophet Muhammad is free from that. It's got nothing to do with those statements. Take only that which has been highlighted from authentic sources and that which is acceptable as highlighted by the ulama. Barakallahu feekum. وجزاكم الله خير. سبحان الله وبحمدك، اشهد ان لا اله الا انت، استغفرك واتوب اليك.
غرباء غرباء ولغير الله لا نحمي الجباه، غرباء وارتضيناها شعارا في الحياه.